For those of you who are just joining us, welcome to the Investigation Track, sponsored by the Delaware Municipal Electric Corporation. I'm Dr. Jamie McCray, environmental social scientist with the Delaware Sea Grant. And thank you for joining the 12 o'clock session, What Can You Do About Microfibers? In this session, we're joined by Delaware Sea Grant's coastal ecologist, Kate Fleming. If you have any questions for our panelists, you will be able to submit them during the presentation using the Q&A app just at the bottom of your screen. And I will return at the end of the presentation to pose as many questions as possible to the speakers. And now I'm going to turn it over to Kate.
Great. Thanks, Jamie. So we are going to be spending the next 20 or 30 minutes or so talking specifically about microfibers and the topic of domestic laundry, which is something that we often get questions about when talking about John and Tobias's microplastic work. So just advance that slide. So to recap, if you were able to attend the previous session or if you're just joining us, microfibers are these tiny thread-like materials that break away from fibrous materials like furniture, rope, paper, and clothing. And microfibers are the most common type of microplastic that have been encountered in Delaware's tributaries and the inland bays, according to John and Tobias's work, with polyester and rayon being the most common types of microfibers encountered in their samples. And they've even found that some of these microfibers are showing up in the stomachs of some of our local seafood, like blue crabs. So these fibers come from textiles that are commonly used in clothing products. And it's widely understood that one of the key contributors to these fibers in the environment is the effluent associated with domestic laundry. So since most of us likely are doing laundry in our lives, or we have someone that's doing it for us, whether that's at home or at a laundromat, this is something we're going to talk about today. So I know when I first started looking into this issue, I really wanted to understand better what all these different fiber types are that are showing up in our clothing. And so they can be broken down into three broad categories, natural, synthetic, or semi-synthetic, with our natural materials, our natural fibers coming from plant and animal sources. So they're not altered by man as they're spun into yarns or woven into cloth. And so they're biodegradable. And if the environmental considerations associated with natural fibers likely are linked more to the farming practices. So for example, if there's a cotton farm that uses pesticides, that's an environmental consideration associated with natural fibers. Then our synthetic fibers are produced using man-made polymers that usually come from the byproducts of petroleum. So these are plastic. And they're based on fossil fuels. They don't degrade, so they persist in the environment. They may break into smaller and smaller pieces, as was discussed in the previous session, but they'll persist in the environment. So the environmental considerations then, when we think about these synthetic fibers, have to do with that lack of biodegradability, as well as we might want to think about the impacts associated with that petroleum industry. So extraction impacts, associated oil spills, air and water emissions associated with that industry. And then finally, semi-synthetic fibers are another man-made type of fibers, but they come from plants. They start with plants. So semi-synthetic fibers are sometimes referred to as regenerated cellulose. Cellulose are the building blocks of plant material. And so in the semi-synthetic process, we have pulp from trees like beech or eucalyptus trees, or maybe the pulp from bamboos or cotton, and then that's dissolved in chemicals and fibers are extruded through this process. So again, semi-synthetic or regenerated cellulose fibers are based on plants, but also chemicals. They do degrade, although we heard in the previous session that they make their way into the stomachs of our seafood before that degrading happens. And so we might keep that in mind, as well as some of the other kinds of environmental considerations related to the air and water emissions related to the toxic chemicals that are used in the process of making these semi-synthetic regenerated cellulose fibers. So we are going to do our first poll. Hopefully you all can see that. And we'll just ask you all, what type of material do you think is the shirt you're wearing today made of? I'll give you a few moments to respond. And I'm not sure if we're at a place where we can share those results. All right. So most people are thinking they're wearing something made of natural materials. We've got some synthetic and some semi-synthetic. All right, cool. So we're gonna move on and we're gonna relate this information back to what actually shows up on your tag. So we're gonna look at this a little bit more. So I think this, at least for me, when I think about natural fabrics, it's a little bit more intuitive for me to recognize natural fabrics on my tag because cotton comes from the seed pods of cotton plants. I think most of us are familiar that wool comes from shearing hairy animals like goats and sheep and even camels. Silk comes from the cocoons of silkworms that are often cultivated. Linen was a little bit less familiar to me. Linen actually comes from the stalks of flax plants. So what they do is soak the flax plants and then dry and then crush it to weave that into a fabric. Our synthetic fabrics that show up on our tags were recognizable to me, but for as many of them, but perhaps not recognizable necessarily as plastic products. So nylon was the first synthetic fabric that was ever created, and the first application in clothing was for women's hosiery. So we still see that, but nylon shows up in other clothing products now today as well. Polyester is a really versatile fiber. It shows up in all different kinds of clothing. I chose to highlight the micro fleece example because we're going to talk about that in a little bit. Acrylic was created to mimic wool. Spandex and elastane are based on polyurethane. So I think you're more likely to come across a spandex or elastane on your tag rather than polyurethane. Lycra is a brand that essentially is interchangeably used with spandex and elastane. So these are all used to create stretch fabrics that you might find in your swimwear or running leggings, for example. And then polypropylene, I think, is a little bit less common. I looked around in my household and wasn't able to find anything made of polypropylene, but polypropylene might show up if you have some pretty extreme cold weather long underwear. And then it's used in like military gear. So cut resistant gloves, ballistic vests, helmets are made of polypropylene. And then our semi-synthetic fabric. So again, this is our regenerated cellulose. And so regenerated cellulose is often terms referred to interchangeably with rayon. So rayon, will oftentimes show up on your tag. And then all of these different kinds of words are actually different types of rayon. So they refer to a different chemical or process to create that rayon or regenerated cellulose. So you might see on your tag just rayon or viscose rayon, or perhaps viscose from bamboo. What that means is that that rayon was produced using bamboo. And then lyocell, I'd like to point out, the industry has recognized some of the environmental issues associated with the creation of these rayon fabrics. And so they work to try and improve and minimize the environmental impact. So lyocell is a third generation rayon that uses a chemical that's easier to filter. And so they can reuse more of that chemical in the production of that rayon. So it's thought to be a little bit better in compared to some of the older processes. And now we're going to ask you to do another poll question. Take a look at the tag on your shirt and let us know what type of material your shirt is made from. Now, we asked you to kind of guess, and now we're going to ask you to take a look. Not necessarily the specific fiber, but the kind of broad category. Is it natural, synthetic, or semi-synthetic? Okay, we'll just give you a few moments to fill that out. And are we ready to share results? Okay. Okay, so cool. Most people are wearing either 100% natural fibers or mostly natural fibers. We have some plastics and a little bit of the semi-synthetic. So interesting, I was kind of thinking about this. I didn't mention it earlier, but the rayons have been produced to kind of mimic silk. So it's got this kind of luxe feel to it. And so I wondered how many people would be wearing rayon today while we're all indoors participating in a virtual event. Okay, so there's interest by the industry as well as scientists to better understand fiber shedding in domestic laundry, recognizing that this is a key contributor to these fibers in our environment. And so there have been plenty of studies that have taken a look at different variables to try and tease out perhaps what are some of the culprits, or can we pull away some best practices to either improve the production at the textile level, the textile production level, or perhaps inform choices for consumers of fabrics, consumers of clothing, and people that do laundry. So the first kind of set of variables that I think about are just comparing, are we looking at polyesters versus cottons, or maybe a polyester cotton blend compared to a rayon. But it's not just about polyester versus cotton, because within there are different types of polyesters, for example, that might shed at different rates. And some of them have short fibers versus long fibers. And some of them might have tight weaves versus loose weaves. And so that's information that you as a consumer will never see on your tag, but that's information the industry can use to help improve their production processes. Then we have machine variables. So everyone's got a different washing machine that maybe it's a front load or a top load, might use different amounts of water, and this can all influence shedding. And then human choices. So there's lots of variables in terms of how much detergent you use, what type of detergent do you use, fabric softener, and then the different cycle types you're choosing and what you're washing. And so there's a lot of variables out there. There's also a lot of literature, but what I found really is the science is still emerging on a lot of this. It's hard to tease out and compare across studies because there are so many variables. For example, I found in most studies that there does seem to be increased shedding associated with the use of detergents, but I didn't necessarily find this across all fabric types, across all studies. There was another study that looked at top loading machines versus a front loading machine and found that the top loader was associated with 7 times the fiber emissions. For whatever that fabric type they were testing. But scientists also pointed out that that top loader had that central agitator, and maybe there was more of a relationship with that. So it's complicated, but I do think that there are things that we're learning, and there's enough information now to draw upon to start thinking about, again, as folks that are consumers, people buying clothing as well as doing laundry. And so the first are pretty basic, fundamental. Domestic laundry is a widespread source of plastic microfiber emissions. We know this. All fabrics shed and will shed over the course of their lifetime. Although according to different clothing types, we may see increased shedding or decreased shedding over the course of their lifetime. But the basic kind of takeaway is all fibers will shed, and they'll shed over the course of their lifetime. We do see consistently that microfleece, which is made of polyester, if you remember back to that example I showed earlier in the presentation, is consistently identified as a high volume emitter of plastic microfibers. And then there are also mitigation tools that can minimize the emissions of microfibers into your washing machine effluent. And we haven't talked about that yet, so we're gonna do that now. So there are a couple of products that I'm aware of that are meant to be used by someone at home or at a laundromat to help minimize emissions while in the middle of your load. So what you can do with a washing bag is place your load in, place your clothing inside that washing bag, and then that goes in your washing machine and you run your machine per usual. Not to confuse these with, there are other, like I have a laundry bag for to protect some of my more delicate clothing, but there are specific bags out there that are meant to capture and inhibit these microfibers from getting released into your washing machine effluent. And then there are also laundry balls. I'm only familiar with this product currently on the market. There are other laundry balls that if you Google that, you might come up with the laundry balls that go in your dryer to replace dryer sheets. That's not what I'm talking about. So the Cora balls have these kind of long tentacles and these deep crevices, and you'll place that in your load, in your washing machine, in the water with your clothes. It'll swirl around and it will capture the microfibers while you're doing your load. So afterwards, you can pull it out, let it dry out, and then remove microfibers from the ball. And then we also have inline filters. So inline filters can be installed on your water line to capture those microfibers before they leave your home. And these are all products, by the way, that have been tested in this study I have down here. I've come across one or two other studies that have tested this. So, but this was the most recent. It was published, I think, in July of 2020. So very recent. And so I'll just mention this X Filtra, which was the most effective inline filter that was tested in this study, is actually intended to be installed at the manufacturing point of that washing machine. And so it was a prototype while the study was going on. And I think right now the company may be working with washing machine companies to try and integrate that technology. So for anyone that might have a washing machine purchase in your future, you might look out for this technology to capture these microfibers. And then otherwise, these are some other products that are out there that are meant to be installed separately. And so you can see that the efficacy kind of ranges anywhere from 25%, so a quarter. It'll capture a quarter to maybe a half of the microfibers in each individual load. So you might consider using one or perhaps a combination of some of these mitigation tools to minimize the emissions of microfibers coming from your household laundry. And so with all of this, I think what we're trying to kind of get at is just pointing to some information to help people draw upon when they're making decisions, when they're purchasing clothing, or in the way they do laundry. So you can consider your fabric choices. You could also consider your wash frequency. And I'm not suggesting that anyone stops washing their laundry, but you might be more mindful about whether or not that microfleece can go through one more wear before you do a wash, for example. And then finally, you might consider using fiber catching products. So we are going to wrap up with another poll, and then I think Jamie might jump in to tell us about some of our follow-ups that we're planning to do after the session. So the last question is, which washing with wisdom practices are you most likely to try, which we just reviewed? Okay, you have a number of options. You might consider your fabric choices or use one of those mitigation tools, inline filters or laundry balls, or maybe you have another idea. We'll give it another minute and then we can see. All right. Hey, Jamie, would you want to jump in to kind of let folks know what's coming? All right, fabric choices and the laundry balls sound popular. Okay, cool. We can take questions, and Jamie, if you want to jump in real quick.
Sure. So for all of you guys who are on this session, you didn't know it, but you could be a winner. We are going to be giving out a couple of these laundry mitigation tools. So look out for an email from us, and hopefully you will be the proud new owner of perhaps a laundry ball or inline filter or something of the sort, so you can move forward with your washing with wisdom practices. Kate, we also have a couple of questions about those practices. A few people asked, how do you dispose of the microfibers after they're captured so you can ensure that they're not getting back into a water source?
Right, yeah. So the goal would be to remove them and then place them in your regular trash so that it ends up in a landfill. That is the kind of end waste management goal.
Great. And this is not necessarily a question, but a comment. I thought that most clothes were made of cotton. Do you have any idea about what percentages of textiles are natural fibers versus other?
I'm afraid to misspeak. I thought that polyester was actually the biggest produced at this point for clothing, but that might be something too. We know that polyester is a, we know polyester is a one of the biggest, if not the biggest. So that's something maybe I can look up and just confirm, so I'm not giving out misinformation.
Sure. We've got another question. What are the best alternatives to microfiber cleaning towels that you can use in your home?
Microfiber cleaning towels, like when you're, you could just use a paper towel. I don't use microfiber cleaning towels, so I don't know what benefits you're gaining over a paper towel or something that's made of a natural fabric.
Yeah, for the person, Caldonia, you can follow up with us in that Q&A box. Is there a particular use for the microfiber towels that you're using? I know that I use a lot of just, cotton dish towels to clean things up around the house. So I'm able to then launder them and reuse them. And we've got Jennifer here who says she uses cotton bar rags. So some other type of natural fiber rag seems to be a nice alternative. Caldonia says that they're used for dusting and cleaning, and she knows that about paper towels, but that's using a whole lot of paper. So would you consider one of them worse? I think we're trying to lessen the amount of plastic that we have going on in our environment. So well managed forest and trees and other things, I think are probably going to be where you would like to err on the side of caution when thinking about the type of material use that you have going. Okay, so we have a few more minutes. I do have another question if John and Tobias are still around for you guys. And there we go. So we have a question. Can you explain why microplastics accumulate in the Tidal River more than the Delaware Bay? This is from Jay.
Tobias, are you there? Do you want to take it? Or I can.
Yeah. Sorry, could you repeat this? Yes.
Sure. Can you explain why microplastics accumulate in the Tidal River more than the Delaware Bay?
Yeah, I think there's reasons that are twofold. One is, of course, a question of what's the source of the microplastics. How does it get into the Tidal River, and then how can it get focused and concentrated? So the Delaware Bay is connected also to the open ocean. So there's also cleaner ocean water that's connecting to Delaware Bay so that the plastics can be concentrated. So that's one reason why tidal rivers concentrations could be higher. But again, remember also that we did find concentration hotspots in the Delaware Bay where concentration could be unexpectedly large. Yeah, John, do you want to add to that?
The only thing I would add to that is, so if you think about the material coming in from land, it's gonna come in through the rivers. And then a fair amount of material is gonna be trapped on the land in wetlands or on the shore. And then that's gonna be continuously released. And so if you think about concentrations being trapped on the coastlines and then coming in through the rivers, there's this constant source Whereas, as Tobias mentioned, the bay can flush. You certainly can have high concentrations at hot spots in the bay as a result of the way the water moves, but you have these continuous inputs from the rivers.
Great. So for the people that are joining us, if you have any last burning questions, now is the time to put those in the question and answer box. We'll give you another five. Here we go. So are laundry balls and washing bags from Microfibers used only once, Kate?
Oh no, they're reusable. They're intended to be used over and over and over again. So you would have a laundry ball that, and from what I understand with the laundry balls, you can use them multiple times before you have to clean them out. What I understand is that you need to pull them out and it's easiest to clean them out if you let them dry first. And that's true with the laundry bags too. Otherwise you're dealing with fibers all over your hands and then you're gonna end up washing your hands and it's gonna go down the drain. So you'll wanna let those dry before you clean them out. But they're absolutely not meant to be single use products. They're meant to be used over and over again.
Thank you. Great, and that basically brings us to time, everyone. So thank you, Kate, for sharing how we can wash with wisdom, and John and Tobias, also thank you guys. I hope everyone who joined us had a wonderful time and was able to get some information about what we can do about keeping microplastics from entering our water systems. You are now going to see a poll with a quick question that will help us gauge your response to this session. Please go ahead and answer that. And thank you again for joining us.